Okay, so having said all that, we'll start class with a prayer. And Terry, you've got the microphone. Yeah.
Dear Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father, for the wonderful weather that we've had so far this winter. We pray, Father, that you'll be with each of us. We are so thankful that we have this opportunity to meet and Doug to break open your word in the wonderful book of Genesis. We pray, Father, that we'll be great listeners, and we pray, Father, for all those that are listening and watching online, that soon they'll be able to be back in our midst and we can get back to the wonderful fellowship that we've been able to have in the past. We pray for the people with COVID. We pray that they'll be able to come through it okay. And we pray, Father, soon this plague will leave our nation and our world. These things we ask in your Son's wonderful, wonderful name. Amen.
Amen. You had that microphone, and I didn't need to repeat everything you had to say because you could have said it right from there. All right. Uh-oh. There we go.
Do I need to turn it off?
Yes, there's a little switch there on the side. Okay, so just as a little bit of review as we get into Genesis, we're going to be covering chapter 2, verse 18 through chapter 3, verse 7 today. Genesis is the first book of the Torah, or the Law, or the Pentateuch, Penta meaning five, so the first five books of the Bible. Moses is considered the author. Jesus confirms that in the Gospel accounts. Often called the patriarchal period. We are going to be looking at the period between creation and the flood. So that's the antediluvian or before the flood period, and most likely a period of about 1,656 years from creation. If you look at the different genealogies and figure it all out, and of course different ones would probably dispute that by a few years. In the beginning are the first three words of it, and that seems to be how it's been named. In Hebrew, Bereshith, and in Greek, it's Geneseos. And you can see the ways in which it's translated throughout the book of Genesis there. All of the Bible and salvation depends on the historicity of Genesis, especially chapters 1 through 12. There's a lot of doctrines that are foundational doctrines that are so important for us in a New Testament age to understand about God and man and sin and salvation, sacrifice. There's a lot of things there that we are working on. And today in particular, we're going to be looking at the subject of marriage and oneness and gender and things like of that nature that are hot button topics out in the world today. So we're going to be looking from a spiritual standpoint on those particular items. So I wanted to start with this picture here. Maybe you've tried to train a dog and you put the biscuit on the dog's nose and he can't eat the biscuit until you give him the command to eat the biscuit, right? And I love this picture because of the dog's eyes. He just looks so intent on that biscuit as he's watching this here. This particular picture, though, came from an article that's listed this way. Owner balancing treat on dog's head causing untold psychological damage. And I don't know, it seems to be the world we're living in right now today, but what's the value in free will? What's the value in self-control? What's the value in obedience? Those are all things that we need to weigh as we talk about the doctrines that we'll be looking at today. Because Adam was only given one command, right? And was that psychological damage for Adam, for God to say you can eat of any tree in the garden except for this one tree, which is the knowledge of good and evil? Is that psychological damage? Is that like balancing a biscuit on the dog's nose? I don't know. Is it psychological damage when we ask our kids to obey us and follow our commands and hopefully become adults in society that will obey authority in other realms, their workplace or maybe a police officer or something like that? What are we really doing? Are we inflicting psychological damage or are we not? I thought we fixed this problem. What happened? There we go. Okay, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. This was review from Sunday. This is the command that was given to Adam. There was one job that Adam had to do. And do we fall into that same pit of temptation and sin when we struggle with the commands of God that are there for our good and not for evil? God wants to see Adam succeed, but the biscuit is balanced on the nose, right? Eve isn't created until later. This is going to become a very important point here. So Adam had to tell her. So when God gave this command in chapter 2, verse 16 and 17 here, only Adam was created. Eve's not going to be created until shortly afterwards here. Why is that important? Because he is the spiritual head of that oneness, that family unit, the marriage that they share together. And it's his job to protect his wife. And he fails in doing that, as we're going to see, because Genesis 3 and verse 6 tells us that he was with her while she was going through the temptations and the deceit that the serpent was bringing to her. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12 confirms to us in the New Testament that it is indeed Adam that sinned first, not Eve. Sometimes Eve gets the bad reputation, but that's not really it at all. It says, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sin, not because we inherit sin, but because we each choose to separate ourselves from God because of our sin. So some cartoons that are kind of fun. The world loves Adam and Eve cartoons, and so there's plenty to choose from here. He says, I didn't know we'd be kicked out of Eden. Nobody ever reads those terms of service agreements. He might just click through those as you're, you know, getting on whatever website or app or getting some new product or something. How about this one? Eve, that's not a salad. That's my dirty laundry. Or this one here. She's working on the family tree. That was simple. You didn't have to work hard, very hard at that at all. And I love this one here. Be honest, Adam. Do these fig leaves make me look fat? The poor guy, right from the very beginning. Right? What chance did he have? Okay, so here's a new text as we go forward here. Then the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. So God, this is partway through day six. Only Adam has been created so far. Eve has not yet been created. And he looks out and says, there's something wrong in what I've created, that it's not good for man to be alone. So it does beg the question, is fellowship with God enough? That oneness that we can share with God in a spiritual sense, is that enough? Or is there something else that we are missing? And I'm not, you know, coming down on single people or anything like that. And some people can do that, and it's wonderful. But it's very rare, and it's very difficult to remain in that particular state. There's something within us that craves that human companionship. So he declares all things very good in 131, the last verse of chapter 1 of Genesis. But it's after he has created both Adam and Eve that he declares everything to be very good. So that was the macro view. Chapter 1 was the macro view of creation, where you see all 6 days of creation and what God did on each one of those days. Here, we're into the chapter 2. It's more the micro view of creation and really focusing in on the second half of day 6. God's already created the animals, and now he's created Adam, and now he's seeing something is not quite right here. And so we get to see in greater detail, that's why I call it the micro view, of what God did on that particular day. So again, I said, are the unmarried or widowed okay with fellowship with God? Is that all they need? In that sort of vertical relationship, that oneness that they can share with God. Or do we need helpmeets? Well, God seemed to think that a suitable helper that's fit was needed. And so what does God do? He brings all of the beasts before Adam first. Mike was mentioning in the afternoon class that this is sort of climactic, a God-like show. You know, you think about all the different miracles in the Bible and how God does things in a big way. But here, he brings all of the animals before Adam, and God knows that none of them are a suitable fit, suitable help for Adam. And yet he brings them all there, but nothing is found that can work. They're not suitable helpmeets. But this is part of man's dominion over creation. If you remember in chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, where we're told that man is made in God's image, part of that work that man was to do was to have dominion over all the beasts and the fish and the birds and everything that creeps and crawls. So here, man is given the job of naming the animals. I heard this comedian recently who said that, you know, Adam probably started out really great and the hippopotamus, you know, comes out with this big name. And then by the end of the day, he's like, cow. He can't think of anything, you know. He's used up all of his intellect there trying to name the animals. Of course, that's just a joke. There's a relationship change that happens between man and the animals. With Adam, you get the idea that Adam is in harmony with the animals and able to interact with them in a good way. And of course, at that point, we looked at this on Sunday, Adam was only eating plants. But here, when they get off the ark in Genesis chapter 9, and we're not going to be here for a few weeks probably, I'm not sure exactly when we do, but it says, "The fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you the green plants, I give you everything, but you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. And for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast, I will require it, and from man." So you see a change in relationship with animals. And you see this. You head out into the woods, and you know, you encounter a chipmunk. And chipmunk, it's a young thing. It's probably never encountered a human being before, but it's scared of you. And yet that same chipmunk would be near a deer or something else that's out there. But it seems to have a fear and a dread. And so there's a relationship change that happens after the ark. When Noah and his descendants get off the ark there. Okay, and so back to Adam. "And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him." So, and God knew this. God still brought the animals around to Adam. He names them all, but there's no helper fit for him. So man is made in God's image. If we needed to try to understand here the difference between the animals and man, we can see that a helper fit for him had to be also made in God's image. It couldn't be a beast of some sort. Animals are not suitable helpers or helpers fit, but they can be good companions or pets, certainly. And we all love our pets and so forth. I like this cartoon here. Or a picture, my emotional support dog after I tell him all my problems. Look at those eyes. So, you know, maybe we put our pets through some of that sometimes when we're, you know, expounding on our problems. And I think pets can certainly understand that we're going through something and want to be with us and give us some kind of comfort and joy. But they're certainly not able to understand in that same way. "So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And that rib, the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man." Well, first of all, Adam, or Adama, I'm supposing it's Hebrew there as a word, but it means ground or dirt. And so Adam was made from dirt, but Eve was made from his rib, not from dirt, but the rib was made from dirt. So that'll been a roundabout way. But woman came from man. After this, all people would be born from women. And this point becomes important here in the next slide or so. But first, a cartoon. Uh-oh, the clicker's doing it again. Is it because I'm hitting this button in the back, maybe? I hope I'm not. Oh, there we go. Okay. So he says, what if this leaves a scar people notice on the beach? Like I said, there's a lot of cartoons out there about this. Okay. Oh, there we go. Okay, so here is the verse that I was speaking about in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It says, for a man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God, but woman is the glory of man. For man was not made from woman, but woman from man. So there we see the creation of Eve there. And then in verse 9, neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. As woman was made from man, so man is now born of woman. That's the way forward from Eve on down. She'd be the mother of nations. And all things are from God. So that comes up in the New Testament time. Then the man said, this at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. That's what woman means. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. There's the definition of marriage. It's God's definition. It's not our definition. It's not ours to play with. There it is, right in verse 24. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. There's the mark of the oneness that we have. Two become one flesh. But the mark of that is that they are naked and not ashamed. And I think the shaming part is important in this. And we often overlook it. It's the part of the definition that allows for the legitimacy of the marital relationship, is that they are naked and not ashamed. That's the only instance where God takes away the shame. It's within the oneness that he created in the marital bond. So God defines marriage. It's not up to man or the world today. I think, in today's culture, you hear about all kinds of different unions that they call marriage out in the world. I even heard a story of a man out in California who married legally his golden retriever. I don't know. Just makes you shake your head a little bit. But that's what's happening today, is all these foundational doctrines are being undercut and eroded in every single way as Satan constantly bombards that which we are trying to base our faith upon. And so it's up to us to get truth out there as to how it is. And so,
very early age, that early man was kind of ignoramus, not too bright.
Caveman, yeah. Kind of thing. He's saying that early man was a caveman.
Yep. Here we have a man who is able to recognize the value of the woman when he sees it.
Yeah, yeah.
And name all the animals.
Right.
That has to take terrible intelligence. I mean, I don't care who you are to come up with that many names, but
right.
but it's just completely different than what most young people are exposed to.
Yeah.
When you stop to think about what went on here.
I think he's saying that the secular world and schools were being taught that early man is sort of an ignoramus, and but we see here some intellect in Adam, and appreciation and a relationship, really, with...
You know, I think the origin of language and words, an interesting study, but it was so laborious, I don't think I'd ever want to try to attempt it, but somebody that has researched and went back as far as they can to understand languages and what God placed in man in the beginning,
right,
probably would come up with some common things, I'm guessing, that would be in languages.
Right. Exactly. Yep, there is, and that's an interesting study. And I have done some of that, but not a lot. But yeah. Okay, so we have, because man is made in God's image, we have a oneness with God. That's how we were created, to be in that relationship and be one with God. And that's the state that Adam and Eve are currently existing at this particular point, is in that spiritual oneness relationship with God. But the only physical or earthly relationship that God ever describes as oneness is between a man and his wife. You know, of course, the two become one. It's a quite a mystery there. But we often think of the physicalness, or the physical oneness, when we think of that marital relationship. But there's also a spiritual, emotional, and mental components as well that go with that oneness. Premarital intimacy prematurely removes the shame. That's what happens. And what is our culture doing today? But it's trying to remove the shame, or the stigma, as they call it, from premarital intimacy, and so make it normal in society. And that's something that we should be accepting of. And when that happens, then the shame is removed from it. We have a generation growing up right now that knows nothing of what God really requires. And so they think it's just a normal, natural thing. They feel a certain way, and so they do a certain way, just as animals might do, being attracted to one another. But we're made in God's image and have a different standard to live by. So here's an example of the shame and what it did to the vertical relationship and the oneness with God here. We're not going to be getting to verse 8 in this study here tonight. We're only going to go up through verse 7. But we can see it says that they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. So they eat of the fruit they shouldn't do in verse 6, and then verse 7 we'll get to tonight. But here they're trying to hide themselves. They feel a certain shame in their nakedness in being with God. And so that oneness, there's a problem in that oneness that they've shared with God up to this time. Sin often is accompanied with shame, or lack of shame, I should say. Here in Jeremiah chapter 8, of course, Jeremiah is writing about the time of the Babylonian captivity. And God, through the prophet Jeremiah, is telling the people that their sin has kept them from blushing. So in other words, it's removed the shame. He says, were they ashamed when they committed abomination? No, they were not at all ashamed. They did not know how to blush. Therefore, they shall fall among the fallen. And so we can see that when shame is removed, that shame is a good thing, because it gives us a tool in which we can gauge ourselves and understand the relationship. If you get to a point where there's no blushing, no shame, and some behavior that you're doing, and it's outside of the oneness with God or the oneness with your spouse, then obviously there's a problem there. Okay, so I wanted to bring up these trees. These are two sycamore trees in Sheridan, Pennsylvania, and they're very well-known trees, and I like to use these trees as an illustration of marriage, because they planted these two sycamores, one on each side of the sidewalk. And I imagine somebody at some point, they probably planted in the 1940s, I was told, by the history on Google. But they came together at some point, and they grew into one tree. And I think this is a great illustration of two becoming one in marriage. And so here it is. So when there's no shame before a marital union, the shame is gone, there's a struggle that happens when the couple does get married. Struggle forming good and godly relationships. And usually those struggles are centered around the oneness that God intended. Maybe someone would be domineering. Anger might be a problem. Clingy, distant, not engaged, a very shallow relationship. Maybe pornography is a problem, or the eye wanders a lot. The pretty girl walks by and the guy's always looking, right? You know, you hear things out in the world like, well, you can look, but you can't touch. But that's not true either. There's a problem there in the oneness. And a lot of times it's because the shame was missing from before the oneness happened. And that's a big problem in our society today, especially as the percentage of people getting married has dropped way below 50% now. In society, they just, people aren't getting married. But the world says, how do you know if it's good until you try it? It's like getting a car. You got to test drive them first. That's what the world says, before you know which car you want to buy. And so that's contributes to the problem of no shame and the problems in the oneness. And so what happens when a marital union ends because a spouse dies? This is something that I've spent a lot of time thinking about. But if you were to cut off the bottom of one of those sycamore trees, you just take a chainsaw and just cut it right off, and then you were to rip it off from where they are joined, do you end up with two trees again? You end up with half of a tree, because two had become one. And so when you split them, they don't become one and one again. They become half and half. That's what happens. And so being widowed is you're being ripped. It's not into two as before, but two halves. And it's very, very difficult. The question of how can I keep upright as what God has made good is no longer there as a fit helper. And those trees have some age on them. If you were to, you know, take them when they were, you know, 40, 50 years younger than they were, it might not be so big a deal. But when you get some decades, some mileage in your marriage on you, and that is ripped apart, how can you withstand the gravity, the pressure of being held upright? It's a very difficult thing. And then for those, you know, if those who are widowed were to get married, okay, you've got a ripped sycamore and you got a ripped maple, but they've developed oneness in other what marriages. How do you put them together and graft them in? Becomes very difficult to do. From what I've been reading and everything else, nothing fills the oneness wound. As terrible and tragic and horrible as losing a parent or losing a child is, those relationships aren't described as oneness in Scripture. It's only the marital bond that's described as oneness. And so when that is ripped apart, there's nothing that can fill that wound, and you'll carry it for the rest of your life in some form or another. Very difficult. People will say, hey, stay busy. And staying busy does distract, but it doesn't let you grieve, and you need to grieve and deal with the grief as it comes up. And if I get a chance to do the grief workshop and the widowhood workshop, I'd really like to be able to bring some of these things up and rely on the experience of many in our congregation. I think we had done a count at one point. I think we're like 23, 24 widows within our congregation, widows and widowers within the congregation. That's a lot. It's a lot. So all of life is about oneness struggles. It's either the oneness with God that we're struggling with, or it's the oneness with our spouse that we're working with. And notice both come up right here in chapter 2 of Genesis. So you can see what's about ready to happen is that Satan, in the beginning of chapter 3, is going to target the oneness with God and the oneness with the spouse, and just throw a ballistic missile right at that foundation and see what he can do. But take a look at this oneness here. John chapter 10 and verse 30, Jesus says, I and the Father are one. And then as he's dying on the cross, about ready to take his last breath, he cries out, having taken on all of the burdens of our sins, being made guilty for everything that we've ever done as that sacrifice for us, he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Meaning that oneness is being ripped apart, that he's always shared with his Father in eternity. But the good news, the gospel, is that we can be restored in our oneness, that we don't have to be separated from God forever, that we can be united with Jesus in his death and be united with Jesus in his resurrection. And so that oneness can be restored in the work that Jesus did on the cross and at the tomb. And so we need to obey the gospel. That's why he is the way, the truth, and the life. And there's no other way to the Father except through him. And that's where the oneness can be restored. That's why Genesis is foundational for everything that we're talking about in the New Testament time. There's a lot of meat here, and it's good to dig through it a little bit. How did we lose our oneness with God? Well, here it goes. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, the last section here of our study tonight. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say, 'You shall not eat of any tree in the garden?'" Now keep in mind that he knows, or you know, the serpent knows here, that Eve was not created yet. She's relying on what Adam, her husband, had told her, and so he's going, and saying, "Well, you got this second hand. This was not right from God himself. Did God actually say that? Are you trusting your husband, who you're one with? Is he really going to steer you wrong? Is he telling you something that God really didn't say?" And we might say to ourselves that we need to have, in our oneness, our relationship with God, we need to know the Word of God better, so that we aren't relying on what somebody else has said or maybe what we heard on social media, but we're going straight to the source to know what God has recorded for us. So we see that this is Satan identified in Revelation 12 and verse 9. It says, "And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him." So this is, evidently Satan, this ancient serpent here that's speaking to Eve. As we go back and we look at what he does and says here, Satan gets her to question God's command. Now keep in mind that command that we looked at the beginning of class was only given to Adam. Eve hadn't been created yet. It says, "The Lord God commanded the man, saying, 'You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die.'" But I'm sure Eve didn't have, something written, down. She couldn't just go back and say, "Well, let's see what the Bible says," and get the exact wording here. She's got to make a choice here. Is she going to believe her husband that she's one with? Is she going to trust God and her vertical oneness and that relationship with him? Notice how Satan goes right to the very heart of what it's all about. Man is made in God's image, and he attacks both the oneness that she shares with Adam and the oneness that she shares with God, and gets her to doubt both of those things. "And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden.'" Notice she doesn't name it. She just kind of refers to it. It's in the midst of the garden. She doesn't say the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. She should have said that. "Neither shall you touch it, lest you die." Now we just looked at the command twice now. We can see that that's not quite right, but she tries. Eve, she's not named Eve until chapter 3 and verse 20. We won't get to that today. She heard it from Adam. He is with her, verse 6 tells us. And so that means that the spiritual head of their relationship, of their oneness, the one who should be protecting her spiritually, who should be saying, Eve, that's not quite right. Here's how the command went. And reiterating it again, he's standing right there and stays silent the entire time that the serpent or Satan is deceiving Eve into questioning her relationship with God and her relationship with him. She states the command, but as neither shall you touch it. We might ask ourselves, do we add or subtract, for that matter, from God's word? When we don't do the study ourselves, when we don't open up the pages of the Word of God and can be in it continually all the time to help teach us what God wants of us and how we should interact with others, then we may be adding or subtracting to God's Word, adding requirements that God never meant, or taking away requirements that God intend for us, even though we might not understand their validity. What do we say as parents? Because I said so, right? Why do we do that? Because maybe explaining is too much. Maybe the kid is not capable of understanding all the reasons behind the command that we've just given them. But it's very important that the kid obeys It's not a bad thing to say because I told you so. That's basically what God says here. And so, lest you die, she says. And so as we talk about death, there's a first death or a separation of the body from the soul, and we'll all experience first death at some point in our lives. So we've all sinned, so we're all going to die. But second death is a separation of the soul from God. And as we're going to see here in the next couple of verses, those who have obeyed the gospel aren't going to experience that second death. Revelation chapter 20, one of the last couple of chapters of the Bible, says, "Blessed and holy is the one who shares in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power. But they will be priests of God and of Christ, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years. In Revelation 21, we see who the second death is intended for. The separation of the soul from God. And it says, "But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." So we see that continuing in our own way is not always the best thing for us. Never the best thing for us. "But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not surely die.'" Wait a minute. What's he doing here? He's saying, God doesn't know what he's talking about. He's saying that God, who you say is good, really doesn't have your best interests at heart. He's only looking out for himself. And so he just gave you those commandments to keep you under control. Really, there's benefit in there for you if you do things your own way. Verse 5, "For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." In other words, you're not like God now. You're made in God's image, but you're not like God now. There's something else that's being kept from you. And if you really want to become like God, you've got to step up and be a God. You've got to make your own choices in your own life. Take control of that and put yourself on the throne and kick God off, and then you can do what you want to do. Isn't that very similar to what we experience with temptation and sin today? Satan adds just one word, "not," to get Eve to believe the good Creator is keeping a good thing from her. Goes right to the heart of God's image, his oneness that she shares with God, and says there's really some problem in that oneness. And the problem is with God himself. The problem is that God is keeping good things back from you. He doesn't want you to become more powerful than you are. He doesn't want you to take charge of your own life. Isn't that what we say to ourselves in the midst of temptation and sin? I can do what I want. Right? If it feels good, do it. Right? That's what life is all about. And that really goes against the oneness that we share with God. It's by knowledge now, not instinct, that we live on earth. So she, knowing good and evil. So that's how it is that we exist now in this world. It's by knowledge. The animals have instinct, right? Take some baby ducks and, right, they're just hatched, but they go out to the water and they know how to swim and everything else. Other animals have instincts that teach them what to do. Their childhood is relatively short. Our childhood is relatively long. Why is that? Because we've got a lot to learn. God knows this. And so we have to gain the knowledge. Why do we have formal schooling? There's a lot of knowledge we've got to try to pass on to our kids so that they can function as adults in society. Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6, God says of his people in the Old Testament time, as they're about ready to go into captivity, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." So they don't know who God is. And so there's, again, our second argument for knowing the Word of God. Because that's how it is that we interact with our world and can understand better the relationship that we have with God and the relationship we should have with others. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, you can almost see her, the wheels turning and the justifying going on here in her mind. that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise. Okay, she went from, no way, no, we're told not to eat fruit from that tree in the midst of the garden, to, well, there might be some benefit to what you're saying here. It is good to eat. It is a delight to the eyes. Look how wonderful that fruit looks. And I suppose it would have the effect of making me wise and like God, as what Satan had just said. She took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Sometimes we come down on Eve, but Adam was right there, and he said nothing. He who was supposed to be the spiritual protector of their oneness remained silent, and he's faulted for it. Reasoned as her own God to approve the sin. She says, I'm in charge of my life. I can do what I want. Eve's spiritual head of their oneness was there. And James 1 and verse 14 and 15 says, but each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. For each and every one of us is probably something different, you know, whatever it is. But, you know, Satan knows what those buttons are. And he'll keep, you know, fanning the flame that you've got going there, adding fuel to the fire. To keep you going, but you're the one who makes the choice. 1 John chapter 2 in the New Testament also speaks of temptation and sin and says here, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, good for food, and the desires of the eyes, delight to the eyes, and pride and possessions, desire to make one wise, is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever. So is it Eve or Adam's fault? We see in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 that Eve is faulted for being deceived. It says, but I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. 1 Timothy 2 also faults her and says, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. But where was Adam? He was with her. And Romans chapter 5 and verse 12 puts the fault clearly in his lap and says, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. So, last verse of the evening, then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. Now remember before, that right after they became husband and wife, and the two shall become one flesh, they were naked and they weren't ashamed. Now they recognize that they're naked, and so they try to take care of their sin. They've just put this wedge in the oneness between themselves and God and really between each other. And so what are they doing? They're hiding their nakedness from each other. They're trying to sew fig leaves together, and they made themselves loincloths, it says. And we're going to see on Sunday morning when Mike picks up the study that they also try to hide their nakedness and their shame from God in their oneness. It says, now they're naked and ashamed as they hide it from their oneness with each other and soon from God's oneness. They try to hide as from him in the garden. So man's attempts to deal with sin are inadequate. How many times do we try to deal with sin in some way that's just not effective? It's not going to take away the sin. We try to get rid of some of the guilt and shame sometimes with sin, of that sin brings us, but it's not really adequate, just like the fig leaves aren't. And so God will soon sacrifice an animal to cover them and giving them the idea that sacrifice is needed for redemption of sin, kind of putting it on the credit card until Jesus comes and pays it in full on the cross. Yes? Yep. Right. So Terry was just referencing Hosea 4:6 that my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, and it brought to his mind Amos 3:3 that were two walk together with purpose, agreeing to walk in purpose there. Yep. Okay, and so loincloths, the last idea here. You know, so God puts fur loincloths around them, and it's the Western culture that has sexualized breasts. It's if you go to native cultures all over the world, you see, you know, many of the women don't wear any tops at all, and but it's only Western culture that has done that. And so oftentimes, even in the cartoons, you'll see Eve, either she's got long hair covering her chest, or she's got fig leaves around around her chest as well. But it's just a final thought there that sometimes we've, throughout history, as missionaries, have gone into you know, these native populations, and we haven't converted them to Christianity. We're converting them to Western culture. And so we got to be careful of that in understanding culture and work around the world. Trying to put European style garments on people may not work in the jungles of Africa or South America or someplace like that. Okay, so to leave you with this question, I got to bring back the dog with the biscuit here. Do you blame, hide, lie, ignore, or justify to bypass God's commandments and sin in doing so? How do we deal with sin today? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity to share your word. We know, Lord, that there are many things that we need to examine in ourselves and the oneness that we should share with you as we have been restored in that oneness through Jesus' redemptive work on the cross. And we pray, Lord, that we would also examine our interpersonal relationships with each other, especially our spouses, in which we are to share that oneness, and help us, Lord, to overcome the sin and struggles that we endure, that we might do everything in accordance with your word and your will for our lives. In Jesus we pray.